Councils of the Faith, the Dadestan Denig of Zoroastrianism. Edited by Alan Lewis Silva. Podcast 2. Chapter 19. The 18th question is that which you ask thus: when the souls of the righteous and the souls of the wicked go out to the spirits, will it then be possible for them to see Ahuram Mazda and Ahriman, or not? The reply is this: that concerning Ahriman it is said that his is no material existence, and Ahuram Mazda, as a spirit among the spirits, is to be heard by those who are material and those also who are spiritual, but his form is not completely visible except through wisdom. An semblance of his power is seen, as was told unto Zarathustra the Spit-Amon when he saw the result of his handiwork, and he spoke thus: grasp the hand of a righteous man, for the kindly operation of my religion through thee thyself is as much as he shall grasp, and thou mayst see him whose reception of my wisdom and glory is the most. And about the souls of the righteous and wicked, in the spiritual places they see the throne, which they deem a sight of Ahuram Mazda. And so also those who are domiciled with Ahriman, through that wisdom with reference to whose creator they shall suffer, will understand minutely as regards Ahuram Mazda and the nature of Ahriman. And he who is of the righteous is delighted at escaping from Ahriman and coming to the existence pertaining to Ahuram Mazda, and they shall offer homage to the glory of Ahuram Mazda. And he who is wicked, through being deceived by Ahriman, and turning from the direction of Ahuram Mazda, becomes more vexed and more penitent, the hope and forgiveness which he possesses, and the retribution and manacling which are his among the fiends and spirits through his own handiwork, are by the permission which comes from the most persistent of the persistent at the period of the resurrection. Chapter 20. The 19th question is that you ask thus: to what place do the righteous and wicked go? The reply is this: that it is thus said that the souls of those passed away and of the dead are 3 nights on earth, and the first night satisfaction comes to them from their good thoughts and vexation from their evil thoughts, the second night come pleasure from their good words and discomfort and punishment from their evil words, and the third night come exaltation from their good deeds and punishment from their evil deeds. And that third night, in the dawn, they go to the place of account on Alberts, the account being rendered they proceed to the bridge, and he who is righteous passes over the bridge on the ascent, and if belonging to the ever-stationary he goes thither where their place is, if along with an excess of good works his habits are correct he goes even unto heaven, and if along with an excess of good works and correct habits he has chanted the sacred hymns he goes even unto the supreme heaven. He who is of the wicked falls from the lower end of the bridge, or from the middle of the bridge, he falls head foremost to hell, and is precipitated unto that grade which is suitable for his wickedness. Chapter 21. The 20th question is that which you ask thus: how are the Chinvat bridge, the Data peak, and the path of the righteous and wicked, how are they when one is righteous, and how when one is wicked? The reply is this: that thus the high priests have said, that the Data peak is in Aaron Vej, in the middle of the world, reaching unto the vicinity of that peak is that beam-shaped spirit, the Chinvat bridge, which is thrown across from the Alberts enclosure back to the Data peak. As it were that bridge is like a beam of many sides, of whose edges there are some which are broad, and there are some which are thin and sharp, its broad sides are so large that its width is 27 reeds, and its sharp sides are so contracted that in thinness it is just like the edge of a razor. And when the souls of the righteous and wicked arrive it turns to that side which is suitable to their necessities, through the great glory of the Creator and the command of Him who takes the just account. Moreover, the bridge becomes a broad bridge for the righteous, as much as the height of 9 spears, and the length of those which they carry is each separately 3 reeds, and it becomes a narrow bridge for the wicked, even unto a resemblance to the edge of a razor. And he who is of the righteous passes over the bridge, and a worldly similitude of the pleasantness of his path upon it is when thou shalt eagerly and unweariedly walk in the golden-colored spring, and with the gallant body and sweet-scented blossom in the pleasant skin of that maiden spirit, the price of goodness. He who is of the wicked, as he places a footstep onto the bridge, on account of affliction and its sharpness, falls from the middle of the bridge, and rolls over head foremost. And the unpleasantness of his path to hell is in similitude such as the worldly one in the midst of that stinking and dying existence, there where numbers of the sharp-pointed darts are planted out inverted and point upwards, and they come unwillingly running, they shall not allow them to stay behind, or to make delay. so much greater than the worldly similitude is that pleasantness and unpleasantness unto the souls, as such as is fit for the spirit is greater than that fit for the world. Chapter 22. The 21st question is that which you ask thus, when he who is righteous passes away, who has performed much worship of the sacred beings, and many duties and good works, do the spirit of creation, the spirit of the sacred ceremony and religion of the Mazda worshippers, the water, earth, plants, and animals, make complaint unto Ahura Mazda, owing to the passing away of him who is righteous, and is it distressing to them when he goes out from the world, or how is it? The reply is this, that as to him who is of the righteous, in his transit of worldly pain in passing away, and also after passing away to the passage onwards which is his limit still in the perplexing account, and, after the account, in his own joy, and in what occurs when his gossips in the world, by whom the spiritual beings are also not unrecognized, nor his position unknown, are in worldly demeanor downcast and grieving, on all these occasions his thoughts, procuring forgiveness, are about the sacred beings, and the spirit of creation, and the good spirit of the religion of the Mazda worshippers, which are in the worldly existence, of which also, in the world, that righteous one is a praiser, an employer, a manager, a protection, and a forbearing friend, shall make an outcry to the Creator about him who is righteous, who is away from worldly protection, also for the granting of a promoter of forbearance, and for a restorer of what is extorted, likewise a petition about the compensatory concomitants. As to his new protection and disposer, and the Almighty Creator responds, and allots a teacher for smiting the fiend, for the satisfaction of the righteous, and for the protection of the good creatures. As it is said, that in every age a high priest of the religion and his managing of the creatures are made manifest, in whom, in that age, the protection of the creatures and the will of the sacred beings are progressing. Chapter 23. The 22nd question is that which you ask thus, when they shall snatch forth the life from the body of man, how does it depart? The reply is this, that it is said to be in resemblance such as when the redness is drawn up out of a fire, for when the inflammable material of a fire is burnt, and has remained without glowing, and when it does not obtain new inflammable material, or extinguishing matter comes upon it, its redness and heat then depart from it, the life, too, on the departure of the breath, does not stay in the body, but in like manner departs. To a like purport the high priests of the religion have also said this, that mortals and men by listening perceive the time when the spirits shall put a noose on the neck, when his time has fully come one then conducts him with a companion, and at his falling are the place of death and cause of death, and having made lethargy deliver him up, and terrified his fever, death seizes decrepitude away from him. The strength in those entrusted with him, and the good proceedings and pursuit of means which remain behind, giving them strength, are the determination that is their own inward physician. And should it be a passing away which obtains no light, and on account of their disquietudes they have gone to the understanders of remedies for strength for the remedial duties, and the way is closed, he proceeds with insufficiency of means. And the soul of the body, which is the master of its house, along with the animating life, goes out of the impotent body to the immortal souls, as a wise master of a house goes out of a foreign house to a residence of the good worship. It was also told to the ancient learned that life is where there is a living spirit within the soul's body, which is connected with the soul, as much as a development of the body, and is the life of the soul of a body of one passed away. Chapter 24. The 23rd question is that which you ask thus, when he who is righteous passes away, where is the place the soul sits the first night, the second, and the third, and what does it do? The reply is this, that thus it is said, that the soul of man, itself the spirit of the body, after passing away, is 3 nights upon earth, doubtful about its own position, and in fear of the account, and it experiences terror, distress, and fear through anxiety about the Chinvat bridge, and as it sits it notices about its own good works and sin. And the soul, which in a manner belongs to that same spirit of the body which is alike experiencing and alike touching it, becomes acquainted by sight with the sin which it has committed, and the good works which it has scantily done. And the first night from its own good thoughts, the second night from its good words, and the third night from its good deeds it obtains pleasure for the soul, and if also, with the righteousness, there be sin which remains in it as its origin, the first punishment in retribution for the evil deed occurs that same third night. The same third night, on the fresh arrival of a dawn, the treasurer of good works, like a handsome maiden, comes out to meet it with the store of its own good works, and, collected by witches, the sin and crime unatoned for come on to the account and are justly accounted for. For the remaining sin it undergoes punishment at the bridge, and the evil thoughts, evil words, and evil deeds are atoned for, and with the good thoughts, good words, and good deeds of its own commendable and pleasing spirit it steps forward unto the supreme heaven, or to heaven, or to the ever-stationary of the righteous, there where there is a place for it in righteousness. Chapter 25. The 24th question is that which you ask thus, when he who is wicked shall die, where is the place the soul sits the first night, the second, and the third, and what does it say and do? The reply is this, that those three nights the soul is upon earth, and notices about the thoughts, words, and deeds of its own body, it is doubtful about its own position, and experiences grievous fear of the account, great terror of the bridge, and perplexing fear on account of hell. Thought is oppressive as an indicator of fear, and the soul, in a manner the spirit of the body, is a computer and acquirer of acquaintance by sight about the good works which it has not done, and the sin which it has committed. And the first night it is hastening away from its own evil thoughts, the second night from its own evil words, and the third night from its own evil deeds, but, owing to the good works which it has done in the world, the first night the spirit of its good thoughts, the second night the spirit of its good words, and the third night the spirit of its good deeds, come unto the soul, and become pleasing and commendable to it. And the third night, on the fresh arrival of a dawn, its sin, in the frightful, polluted shape of a maiden who is an injurer, comes to meet it with the store of its sin, and a stinking northerly wind comes out to meet it, and it comes on shudderingly, quiveringly, and unwillingly running to the account. And through being deceived and deceiving, heresy, unrelenting and false accusation of constant companions, and the widespread sinfulness of a fiend-like existence it is ruined, falls from the bridge, and is precipitated to hell. Chapter 26. The 25th question is that which you ask thus, how are the nature of heaven, and the comfort and pleasure which are in heaven? The reply is this, that it is lofty, exalted, and supreme, most brilliant, most fragrant, and most pure, most supplied with beautiful existences, most desirable, and most good, and the place and abode of the sacred beings. And in it are all comfort, pleasure, joy, happiness, and welfare, more and better even than the greatest and most supreme welfare and pleasure in the world, and there is no want, pain, distress, or discomfort whatever in it, and its pleasantness and the welfare of the angels are from that constantly beneficial place, the full and undiminishable space, the good and boundless world. And the freedom of the heavenly from danger from evil in heaven is like unto their freedom from disturbance, and the coming of the good angels is like unto the heavenly one's own good works provided. This prosperity and welfare of the spiritual existence is more than that of the world, as much as that which is unlimited and everlasting is more than that which is limited and demoniacal. Chapter 27. The 26th question is that which you ask thus, how are the nature of hell, and the pain, discomfort, punishment, and stench of hell? The reply is this, that it is sunken, deep, and descending, most dark, most stinking, and most terrible, most supplied with wretched existences, and most bad, the place and cave of the demons and fiends. And in it is no comfort, pleasantness, or joy whatever, but in it are all stench, filth, pain, punishment, distress, profound evil, and discomfort, and there is no resemblance of it whatever to worldly stench, filthiness, pain, and evil. And since there is no resemblance of the mixed evil of the world to that which is its soul indicating good, there is also a deviation of it from the origin and abode of evil. And so much more grievous is the evil in hell than even the most grievous evil on earth, as the greatness of the spiritual existence is more than that of the world, and more grievous is the terror of the punishment on the soul than that of the vileness of the demons on the body. And the punishment on the soul is from those whose abode it has become, from the demons and darkness, a likeness of that evil to hell, the head of whom is Ahriman the deadly. And the words of the expressive utterance of the high priests are these, that where there is a fear of every other thing, it is more than the thing itself, but hell is a thing worse than the fear of it. Chapter 28. The 27th question is that which you ask thus: why and what is the ceremony of the three nights, when during 3 days they order and perform the sacred cake ceremony of Sra'asha? The reply is this: that the life and soul, when from the realm of the spirit of air they attain unto worldly attire, and have passed into its pain and misfortune, are more sensitive, owing to their nurture, birth, and mission. Protection and defense are more desirable and more suitable for the discreet, and milk food, and renewed and constant attention to the fire are requisite. So also when they are ousted from bodily existence, and pain and the eradication of life have come upon them, they are in like manner more sensitive, and sending them protection and defense from spirits and worldly existences is more desirable. And on account of their spiritual character, the offering of gifts for the angels, fit for the ritual of a spirit, is more presentable, and also a fire newly tended is that which is more the custom in the sacred ceremony. For the same reason, in the 3 days when in connection with the soul the sacred ceremony, the burning of fire, its cleanly clearance, and other religious and ritualistic defense, feeding on milk and eating with a spoon are ordered, because, as the sacred ceremony, the defense and protection of the worldly existences, is, by order of the Creator, the business of Sra'asha the righteous, and he is also one of those taking the account in the three nights, Sra'asha the righteous gives the soul, for 3 days and nights, the place of the spirit of air in the world, and protection. And because of the protectiveness of Sra'asha, and that one is assisted likewise by Sra'asha's taking the account, and for that purpose, are the manifest reasons for performing and ordering the ceremony of Sra'asha for 3 days and nights. And the 4th day the ordering and performing the ceremony of the righteous guardian spirit are for the same soul and the remaining righteous guardian spirits of those who are and were and will be, from Gayomard the propitious to Sayashant the triumphant. Chapter 29. The 28th question is that you ask thus: for what reason is it not allowable to perform the ceremony of Sra'asha, the living spirit, along with other propitiations, when they reverence him separately? The reply is this: that the Lord of all things is the Creator who is persistent over his own creatures, and a precious work is his own true service which is given by him to Sra'asha the righteous, whom, for this reason, one is to reverence separately when even his name is not frequently mentioned, and one is not even to reverence the names of the Amisha spent with him. Chapter 30. The 29th question is that which you ask thus: the 3rd night, in the light of dawn, what is the reason for consecrating separately the 3 sacred cakes with 3 dedications? The reply is this: that 1 sacred cake, whose dedication is to Rashnu and Arshtat, is for satisfying the light of dawn and the period of Ushahin, because the mountain Ashdashtar is mentioned in the propitiation of the angel Arshtat. With Arshtat is the propitiation of the period of Ushahin, and she is the ruler of glory of that time when the account occurs. The souls are in the light of the dawn of Ushahin when they go to the account, their passage is through the bright dawn. 1 sacred cake, which is in propitiation of the good V, is, moreover, on this account, whereas the bad V is a despoiler and destroyer, even so the good V is a resister, and likewise encountering the bad V, he is also a diminisher of his abstraction of life, and a receiver and protection of life, on account of the sacred cake. Chapter 31. The 30th question is that which you ask thus: when a soul of the righteous goes on to heaven, in what manner does it go? Also, who receives it, who leads it, and who makes it a household attendant of Ahura Mazda? Also, does any one of the righteous in heaven come out to meet it, and shall any thereof make inquiry of it, or how? Shall they also make up an account as to its sin and good works, and how is the comfort and pleasantness in heaven shown to it? Also, what is its food? Is it also their assistance which reaches unto the world, or not? And is the limit of heaven manifest, or what way is it? The reply is this: that a soul of the righteous steps forth unto heaven through the strength of the spirit of good works, along with the good spirit which is the escort of the soul, into its allotted station and the uppermost which is for its own good works, along with the spiritual good works, without those for the world, and a crown and coronet, a turban sash and a 4-fold fillet pendant, a decorated robe and suitable equipments, spiritually flying unto heaven or to the supreme heaven, there, where its place is. And Vo human, the archangel, makes it a household attendant to Ahura Mazda the creator, and by order of Ahura Mazda announces its position and reward, and it becomes glad to beg for the position of household attendant of Ahura Mazda, through what it sees and knows. Ahura Mazda the creator of good producers is a spirit even among spirits, and spirits even have looked for a sight of him, which spirits are manifestly above worldly existences. But when, through the majesty of the creator, spirits put on worldly appearances, or are attending to the world and spirit, and put away appearance, then he whose patron spirit is in the world is able to see the attending spirits, in such similitude as when they see bodies in which is a soul, or when they see a fire in which is Virethragna, or see water in which is its own spirit. Moreover, in that household attendance, that Ahura Mazda has seen the soul is certain, for Ahura Mazda sees all things, and many even of the fiend's souls, who are put away from those of Ahura Mazda in spiritual understanding, are delighted by the appearance of those of Ahura Mazda. And the righteous in heaven, who have been his intimate friends, of the same religion and like goodness, speak to him of the display of affection, the courteous inquiry, and the suitable eminence from coming to heaven, and his everlasting well-being in heaven. And the account as to sin and good works does not occur unto the heavenly ones, it is itself among the perplexing questions of this treatise, for the taking of the account and the atonement for the sins of a soul of those passed away and appointed unto heaven happens so, although its place is there until the renovation of the universe, and it has no need for a new account. And that account is at the time the account occurs, those taking the account are Ahura Mazda, Vohuman, Mitra, Sraasha, and Rashnu, and they shall make up the account of all with justice, each one at his own time, as the reply is written in its own chapter. As to that which you ask concerning food, the meals of the world are taken in two ways, one is the distribution of water in haste, and one is with enjoyment to the end, but in heaven there is no haste as to water, and rejoicing with much delight they are like unto those who, as worldly beings, make an end of a meal of luxury. To that also which is the spiritual completion of the soul's pleasure it is attaining in like proportion, and in its appearance to worldly beings it is a butter of the name of Mediozerum. And the reason of that name of it is this, that of the material food in the world that which is the product of cattle is said to be the best, among the products of cattle in use as food is the butter of milk, and among butters that is extolled as to goodness which they shall make in the second month of the year, and when Mitra is in the constellation Taurus, as that month is scripturally called Zermaya, the explanation of the name to be accounted for is this, that its worldly representative is the best food in the world. And there is no giving out of assistance by the soul of the righteous from heaven and the supreme heaven, for, as to that existence full of joy, there is then no deserving of it for anyone unless each one is fully worthy of it. But the soul has a remembrance of the world and worldly people, its relations and gossips, and he who is unremembered and unexpecting is undisturbed, and enjoys in his own time all the pleasure of the world as it occurs in the renovation of the universe, and wishes to attain to it. And, in like manner, of the comfort, pleasure, and joy of the soul, which, being attained in proportion, they cause to produce in heaven and the supreme heaven, its own good works of every kind are a comfort and pleasure such as there are in the world from a man who is a wise friend, he who is a reverent worshipper, and other educated men, to her who is a beautiful, modest, and husband-loving woman, she who is a manager under protection, and other women who are clever producers of advantage. This, too, which arises from beasts of burden, cattle, wild beasts, birds, fish, and other species of animals, this, too, from luminaries, fires, streams, wines, decorations, metals, and colored earths, this, too, which is from the fences of grounds, houses, and the primitive lands of the well-yielding cattle, this, too, which is from rivers, fountains, wells, and the primary species of water, this, too, which is from trees and shrubs, fruits, grain, and fodder, salads, aromatic herbs, and other plants, this, too, which is the preparation of the land for these creatures and primitive creations, this, too, from the species of pleasant tastes, smells, and colors of all natures, the producers of protections, the patron spirits, and the appliances of the patron spirits, can come unto mortals. And what the spirit of good works is in similitude is expressly a likeness of stars and males, females and cattle, fires and sacred fires, metals of every kind, dogs, lands, waters, and plants. The spiritual good works are attached to the soul, and in the degree and proportion which are their strength, due to the advancement of good works by him who is righteous, they are suitable as enjoyment for him who is righteous. He obtains durability thereby and necessarily preparation, conjointly with constant pleasure and without a single day's vexation. There is also an abundant joyfulness, of which no example is appointed in the world from the beginning, but it comes thus to those who are heavenly ones and those of the supreme heaven, and of which even the highest worldly happiness and pleasure are no similitude, except through the possession of knowledge which is said to be a sample of it for worldly beings, and of its indications by the world the limited with the unlimited, the imperishable with perishableness, the consumable with inconsumableness are then no equivalent similitudes of it. And it is the limited, perishable, and consumable things of the world's existence which are the imperishable and inconsumable ones of the existence of endless light, the indestructible ones of the all-beneficial and ever-beneficial space, and the all-joyful ones, without a single day's vexation, of the radiant supreme heaven. And the throne of the righteous in heaven and the supreme heaven is the reward he obtains first, and is his until the resurrection, when even the world becomes pure and undisturbed, he is himself unchangeable thereby, but through the resurrection he obtains what is great and good and perfect, and is eternally glorious. Chapter 32. The 31st question is that which you ask thus: when he who is wicked goes to hell, how does he go, and in what manner does he go? Also, who comes to meet him, and who leads him to hell? Also, does any one of the infernal ones come to meet him, or how is it? Shall they also inflict punishment upon him, for the sin which he has committed, at once, or is his punishment the same until the future existence? Also, what is their food in hell, and of what description are their pain and discomfort, and is the limit of hell manifest, or how is it? The reply is this: that a soul of the wicked, the fourth night after passing away, its account being rendered, rolls head foremost and totters from the Chinvat bridge, and Visarash, the demon, conveys him cruelly bound therefrom, and leads him unto hell. And with him are the spirits and demons connected with the sin of that soul, watching in many guises, resembling the very producers of doubt, the wounders, slayers, destroyers, deadly ones, monsters, and criminals, those who are unseemly, those, too, who are diseased and polluted, biters and tearers, noxious creatures, windy stenches, glooms, fiery stenches, thirsty ones, those of evil habits, disturbers of sleep, and other special causers of sin and kinds of perverting, with whom, in worldly semblance, are the spiritual causers of distress. And proportional to the strength and power which have become theirs, owing to his sin, they surround him uncomfortably, and make him experience vexation, even unto the time of the renovation of the universe. And through the leading of Visarash he comes unwillingly unto hell, becomes a household attendant of the fiend and evil one, is repentant of the delusion of a desire for fables, is a longer for getting away from hell to the world, and has a wonderful desire for good works. And his food is as a sample of those which are among the most fetid, most putrid, most polluted, and most thoroughly unpleasant, and there is no enjoyment and completeness in his eating, but he shall devour with a craving which keeps him hungry and thirsty, due to water which is hastily sipped. Owing to that vicious habit there is no satisfaction therefrom, but it increases his haste and the punishment, rapidity, and tediousness of his anguish. The locality in hell is not limited before the resurrection, and until the time of the renovation of the universe he is in hell. Also out of his sin is the punishment connected with it, and that punishment comes upon him, from the fiend and spirit of his own sin, in that manner and proportion with which he has harassed and vexed others and has reverenced, praised, and served that which is vile. And at the time of the renovation, when the fiend perishes, the souls of the wicked pass into melted metal for 3 days, and all fiends and evil thoughts, which are owing to their sin, have anguish effectually, and are hurried away by the cutting and breaking away of the accumulation of sin of the wicked souls. and by that preeminent ablution in the melted metal they are thoroughly purified from guilt and infamy, and through the perseverance and mercifulness of the preeminent persistent ones they are pardoned, and become most saintly pure ones, as it is said in metaphor that the pure are of two kinds, one which is glorious, and one which is metallic. And after that purification there are no demons, no punishment, and no hell as regards the wicked, and their disposal also is just, they become righteous, painless, deathless, fearless, and free from harm. And with them comes the spirit of the good works which were done and instigated by them in the world, and procures them pleasure and joy in the degree and proportion of those good works. But the recompense of a soul of the righteous is a better formation and more. Chapter 33. As to the 32nd question and reply, that which you ask is thus, in which direction and which land is hell, and how is it? The reply is this, that the place of a soul of the wicked, after the dying off of the body, is in three districts. One of them is called that of the everstationary of the wicked, and it is a chaos, but the evil is abundantly and considerably more than the good, and the place is terrible, dark, stinking, and grievous with evil. And one is that which is called the worst existence, and it is there the first tormentors and demons have their abode, it is full of evil and punishment, and there is no comfort and pleasure whatever. And one is called Druhaskan, and is at the bottom of the gloomy existence, where the head of the demons rushes, there is the populous abode of all darkness and all evil. These three places, collectively, are called hell, which is northerly, descending, and underneath this earth, even unto the utmost declivity of the sky, and its gate is in the earth, a place of the northern quarter, and is called the Arizur Ridge, a mountain which, among its fellow mountains of the name of Arizur that are amid the rugged mountains, is said in Revelation to have a great fame with the demons, and the rushing together and assembly of the demons in the world are on the summit of that mountain, or as it is called the head of Arizur. Chapter 34. As to the 33rd question and reply, that which you ask is thus, in what manner is there one way of the righteous from the day to peak to heaven, and one of the wicked to hell, and what is their nature? The reply is this, that, one is for ascent, and one for descent, and on account of both being of one appearance I write thus much for understanding and full explanation, that is to say, the righteous souls pass over on the Chinvat bridge by spiritual flight and the power of good works, and they step forth up to the star, or to the moon, or to the sun station, or to the endless light. The soul of the wicked, owing to its falling from the bridge, its lying demon, and the pollution collected by its sin, they shall lead therefrom to the descent into the earth, as both ways lead from that bridge on the day to peak. Chapter 35. The 34th question is that which you ask thus, does this world become quite without men, so that there is no bodily existence in it whatever, and then shall they produce the resurrection, or how is it? The reply is this, that this world, continuously from its immaturity even unto its pure renovation has never been, and also will not be, without men, and in the evil spirit, the worthless, no stirring desire of this arises. And near to the time of the renovation the bodily existences desist from eating, and live without food, and the offspring who are born from them are those of an immortal, for they possess durable and blood-exhausted bodies. Such are they who are the bodily existing men that are in the world when there are men, passed away, who rise again and live again.